Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjanasalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Vanchakalpatarubhyasya Kripasindhubhyayivacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gauratvijaya Nama Gurave Gaurachandraya Radhikaya Taradaya Krishnaya Krishna Bhaktaya Tadabhaktaya Namo Nama Tavai Vasmi Najivami Tvayavina Iti Vigyaya Radhe Tangne Maam Charana Yesterday we हम लोग कल भागवत से आरंभ किया सुत गोस्वामी अपने गुरु सुखदेव गोस्वामी को प्रणाम करके भागवत की कथा आरंभ की और उन्होंने कहा उत्तर दिया उनके प्रश्न का कैसे आत्मा सुप्रसन्न हो सकती है उसी के लिए उत्तर में कहा एकमात्र भगवान की तन से मन से वचन से जितनी भी क्रियाएं हैं भावनाएं हैं सबको गुरु वैष्णव के अनुगत्य में निरंतर जमई तैरधारावत अभिच्छिन्न गति से करे और कोई भी संसारी कामना वासना न रहे और वो ज्ञान और कर्म के द्वारा योग के द्वारा आच्छादित न हो इसी को हमारे श्रील रूप गोस्वामी ने अन्य अभिलाषिता शून्यम ज्ञान कर्म आद्यनावृतम आनुकूल्यन कृष्णानुशीलनम भक्ति रुत्तम कहा है इसी को आज हमारे पद्मनाभ महाराज जी इसको एक्सप्लेन करेंगे कल से आप लोग कृपया ठीक 6 बजे शाम को आ जाया करें
6 से पहले
जिससे कि हम लोग 6 बजे आरंभ कर दें
ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांदस्य ज्ञानञ्जनशलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई एम ऑफरिंग माय अनलिमिटेड दंडवत प्रणाम्स टू द लोटस फीट ऑफ माय बिलव्ड दीक्षा गुरु नित्यलीला प्रविष्ट ओम विष्णुपाद अष्टोत्तर सत श्री शिला A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Prabhupada. And secondly, I'm offering my equal Dandavat Pranams and my Shraddha Pushpanjali to the lotus feet of my beloved Siksha Guru Devs, Nityalila Pravishta Om Vishnu Pad Astotarasata Shri Shila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Goswami Maharaj, and Om Vishnu Pad Astotarasata Shri Shila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, to all the lotus feet of my Rupa Nuga Guru Varga, and to all the Vaishnavas, Vaishnavis, friends and guests in this auspicious Harikatha assembly. Yesterday, we were very fortunate to hear from the lotus mouth of our beloved Srila Gurudev the enlightening introduction to the Srimad Bhagavatam, the king of all Vedic literatures. And therein, Srila Gurudev was discussing how Suta Goswami began to explain and answer the questions of the sages who were there. Thousands of great learned sages were there. And they were inquiring from him how the Atma, how the soul can achieve sampradhiti, complete satisfaction and happiness. So how can everyone, every living being, become happy? And there, when Suta Goswami began to answer them, he explained that it is only by unalloyed bhakti, ahoy to ki, without any other motivations, pure bhakti to the lotus feet of Bhagavan, Sri Krishna, that the soul can achieve happiness. He said, Savai pungsang paro dharmo, yato bhaktir adhokshaje, ahoy to ki apratihata, ye atma samprasidati. So there he explained that the highest dharma, the paradharma of every soul is to perform ahoy to ki bhakti, pure devotion to the Supreme Lord, without any other motivation than that that devotion should be pleasing and should give happiness to Bhagavan. And also it should be uninterrupted. That means that it is not that you are doing it only once in a while, only a few minutes or a few hours in the day or in the week, but it is nairantarya mayi. That means that it is uninterrupted, going on constantly, flowing like a stream of honey. So in this way, Srila Suta Goswami described the ultimate occupation of every living being as the paradharma. So that definition of bhakti given there was studied by the great eternal associate of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Srila Rupa Goswami Pad. And Srila Rupa Goswami, he actually wrote the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, in which he gave all the definition of bhakti, and he gave all the descriptions of how this bhakti can be perfected and by which the living being can ultimately attain his eternal treasure of developing divine love for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagavan Sri Krishna. So in the beginning of that literature, Srila Rupa Goswami took the definitions from all different Vedic literatures and he wrote one verse in which that one verse encapsulated completely and described completely the perfect definition of bhakti. What is this para dharma, this pure devotion and pure bhakti to the Supreme Lord? By understanding this definition, then we will actually be able to enter into this. But by misunderstanding, not understanding correctly what bhakti is, then it is not possible to do it. So this verse, it was also commented upon by our great acharyas in our line, like Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Our Srila Gurudev has also given us the translation of this great literature, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu Bindu, in which Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he is giving a description of every word of this verse of Srila Rupa Goswami. So this verse, it is goes like this. Anya Vilashita Shunyam Jnana Karmadi Anavritam Anakulyena Krishnanu Shilanam Bhaktir Uttamam. So here he is explaining what is called Uttama Bhakti, or topmost pure bhakti. Just like when we speak of water, we speak of pure water, not water that is contaminated or anything that is added to it. So similarly, here, Srila Rupa Goswami is speaking about Uttam Bhakti, pure devotion to the Supreme Lord. So here, the definition verse that is described here, it has two parts. That means the Swarup Lakshan and the Tatastha Lakshan. That means the characteristics which are the original or the mool, the important characteristics of bhakti, and the Tatastha Lakshan, that means the marginal characteristics of bhakti. So here, the first two lines of this verse are explaining the Tatastha Lakshan, marginal characteristics of bhakti. What is that? That Anya Abhilashita Shunyam Jnana Karmadi Anavritam. If it is going to be Shuddha Bhakti, pure bhakti to Krishna, then it must be completely devoid of all other desires. Anya abhilashita shunyam. It must not have even a tinge of any other desire than to give happiness to Krishna, to benefit Krishna. So here, anya abhilashita shunyam jnana karmadi anavritam. He explains here that three types of desires, they will cover bhakti. So pure bhakti must not be covered by these three. What are they? Jnana, karmadi, anavritam. First of all, karma. Karma means sense enjoyment. Desiring material enjoyment for my own happiness. That can also mean even attaining after this life elevation to higher planets like Swargalok, heavenly planets, and attaining happiness there on the level of demigods. So that desire for material enjoyment in this world, in this life, or even in future lives, that tendency to gain one's personal sense enjoyment, it will cover one's bhakti. So Shuddha Bhakti cannot be covered by that. Jnana Karmadi Anavritam. Then Jnana. Jnana means not knowledge about the Supreme Lord's transcendental personality. That type of jnana is favorable for bhakti. But the jnana which is tending toward impersonal liberation, mukti, in which the soul tries to merge within the existence of the Supreme. Most persons nowadays, they have this misunderstanding that the jiva, the jivatma, when he attains moksha, the liberation from this cycle of birth and death, that he will merge his existence within the existence of the Supreme, all-pervasive Brahma. So that is a completely incorrect understanding of Vedic knowledge and Vedic truth, because the jivatma is eternal. But those who desire, who cultivate this type of impersonal jnana, nirvishesh jnana, then they will tend to lose their personal existence. So this type of tendency cannot be there in one's performance of bhakti, otherwise it will cover bhakti. But knowledge of the individual nature of the soul, it is called tvam padartha jnana. That knowledge is very good, to understand that I am eternal, servant of God, servant of Krishna, that my existence is meant for His happiness. And tvam padartha jnana means the knowledge of the Supreme Lord, how He is the Supreme Creator and Controller of every living being, and we are possessed by Him. Therefore, our existence is meant for His happiness. So this type of knowledge is helpful for cultivating bhakti. And then, adi, karmadi. Adi is referring to other types of motivations for happiness in this world, like the practice of the Ashtanga Yoga, mystic yoga system. Some persons also like to cultivate this type of transcendental activity, in which they practice Ashtanga Yoga, and gradually, by their very strict practices, they achieve mystic yoga siddhis. These they are not spiritual achievements, they are material achievements. Some mystic yogis can achieve these different eight types of mystic yoga siddhis or perfections, like anima siddhi, lagima siddhi. They can become very small, very tiny. They can become very great. They can reach out their hand, prapti siddhi, and take anything from within this universe. Like this. We even see nowadays, in India, this is very common, that some persons have some mystic yoga power, and they can produce ashes in their hand or something like this, and they will try to impress people with this mystic power. But here, Rupa Goswami is saying that if someone becomes enamored and motivated by attaining such mystic power, then what will be the result? He cannot do this Shuddha Bhakti. He cannot do Para Bhakti to Bhagavan. So his bhakti will be covered. So these are the Tatashta Lakshan. These are the marginal characteristics of bhakti. But then in the next line, Srila Rupa Goswami, he is describing the Swarup Lakshan. That means the intrinsic characteristics that define what really is bhakti. So what is that? Anakulyena Krishna Anushilanam. So here, the word anushilanam means a constant cultivation, constantly utilizing one's body, the senses of one's body, one's mind, one's words, and also one's emotions and desires. When all of these are constantly being cultivated under the direction of perfected guru, of real Satguru, who knows the absolute truth, and one is serving his order and serving Bhagavan Krishna under his direction, this is called anushilanam. And this anushilanam refers to constant, like the flowing of a jar of honey. If you pour honey out of a jar, it doesn't come out in little droplets, but it comes out in one solid flowing stream. So in the same way, real Shuddha Bhakti will be constantly flowing 24 hours daily without any interruption by one's body, mind, words, and desires. And anukul means that it must be favorable for Krishna's benefit. Now here, our acharyas have also given some very specific description of this understanding of anukul. Because we see in the pastimes of the Supreme Lord described in 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, like for example, when Krishna came into the wrestling arena of Kamsa, and there he saw Chanur and Mushtik, very powerful wrestlers. And actually, Krishna often, in his pastimes in Braja, Vrindavan, he would wrestle all the time with his sakas, his cowherd boyfriends. And he would have so much pleasure and happiness from this. So coming into this wrestling arena, Krishna, who is the enjoyer and taster of all rasa, he is Rasika Shekhar. So Krishna also desired to enjoy this activity of wrestling with the wrestlers. But what was their intention? Not to give Krishna happiness and pleasure, no. Their intention was to kill Krishna. That was their order from King Kamsa. So when they were wrestling with Krishna, it was giving Krishna pleasure, because he was tasting ras, vira ras, chivalry. But the wrestlers, they were trying to kill Krishna. So can we say that because they were giving happiness to Krishna, that it was bhakti? No. We cannot. So this is an overextension of the definition. That means that if someone says that just because Krishna becomes happy, that it becomes bhakti. No, it cannot be accepted like that. And then there's also the possibility of underextension of the definition of bhakti. For example, Mother Yashoda, Krishna's own mother in Vrindavan, her every activity, her every thought, her whole existence is for Krishna, for her beloved son Krishna. She is the emblem of motherhood and divine love in Vatsalya Prem. So she is constantly absorbed 24 hours a day. Everything that she does is for the benefit of her beautiful son Krishna. But we see in one of Krishna's pastimes, his Damodar Bandana Leela. So in that Leela, Krishna, he came one morning, he woke up one morning, and Mother Yashoda, she was churning yogurt into butter. And Krishna came when he was very tiny and pulled on Mother Yashoda's sari and wanted to drink her breast milk. So Mother Yashoda, she immediately took Krishna upon her lap and she fed her breast milk to Krishna. But then what happened? She was simultaneously boiling pots of milk on the stove. And suddenly, the milk began to boil over on the stove. So she suddenly put Krishna down very quickly, and she rushed over to save the milk from boiling on the stove. But what happened? Did Krishna become happy from this? No, he became upset. He became angry to the extent that he thought, I will do some mischief. And then the whole Leela ensued where Krishna went and began to break the pots of yogurt and feed it to the monkeys and so forth. So Krishna, he became angry and upset that his mother had stopped giving her breast milk. But Mother Yashoda was going to take care of the pots of milk on the stove. Why? Because this is for Krishna's benefit. She is going to make very beautiful milk sweets, pera, and so many other preparations, rasgullas, and she is going to give them to Krishna for his benefit, for his happiness. So although Krishna was at that moment not pleased by what she did, but her activity was bhakti. It was the highest form of bhakti because it was for Krishna. So in this way, our acharyas have given these very specific definitions that we can understand what is the true nature of anukul, to be favorable for Krishna. So in this way, Rupa Goswami has defined bhakti. There are many, many other more specific understandings by breakdowns of all the different words within the shloka. But in general, this is the meaning of bhakti. So without understanding what pure bhakti is, what shuddha bhakti is, then we can be mistaken and we can perform something that is only a semblance of bhakti. And there are different types of semblances, bhakti abhas, like aropa siddha bhakti, sangha siddha bhakti. But real bhakti is swarup siddha bhakti, which is the pure nature of the soul. And that bhakti, it is done by the process of nava vidha bhakti, meaning shravanam, kirtanam, vishnu, smaranam, padasevanam, archanam, bandhanam, dasyam, sakyam, atmani, vedanam. This definition was given by Sri Prahlad Maharaj in Srimad Bhagavatam. So our acharyas are teaching us how to perform pure bhakti, because only by this process can we attain the ultimate goal of life. And therefore the whole Srimad Bhagavatam is beginning with this definition of bhakti. Savai pungsam paro dharmo yato bhaktir adhokshaje ahoituki apratihata ye atma samprasidati. In this way, the atma will be pleased. Who is the atma? Ultimately, the Atma, the Supreme Atma, the Paramatma, that is Krishna, Bhagavan Sri Krishna himself. So if we perform this kind of bhakti, then Krishna will be pleased, and the result of that bhakti is that we will attain divine praying for the lotus feet of Krishna. Vancha kalpatu vishcha kripa sindhu bheva chakrapatam.
Aap logo ne भक्ति की परिभाषा सुना, इसमें आप लोगों ने देखा यद्यपि चारण मुष्टिक कृष्ण को वीर रस आस्वादन करा रहे हैं किंतु जान से मार डालना चाहते हैं, इसलिए यह भक्ति के अनुकूल नहीं है, यह प्रतिकूल है, इसलिए प्रतिकूल चीजों को नहीं करना चाहिए भक्ति के विरुद्ध। दूसरी बात, यशोदा मैया का दिखलाया गया, कृष्ण ने दधि के मटके को फोड़ दिया, सारा दूध निकल गया, बेंत एक हाथ में लेकर कृष्ण को मारने के लिए दौड़ी और उन्हें पकड़ लिया और कहा, जी बदमाश, नटखट लड़का, तुमको अभी मारूंगी। और कृष्ण छटपट छटपट करके रोने लगे। कृष्ण विश्व ब्रह्मांड के रचयिता जो हैं, उनके भी ईश्वर के ईश्वर हैं, सर्वशक्तिमान हैं, किंतु आज यशोदा मैया की लठिया से डर गए और आंखों से आंसुओं की धारा गिरने लगी। क्या उन्होंने ये सचमुच रोया अथवा कोई अभिनय किया? अभिनय नहीं, कृष्ण के लीला में जोग माया कृष्ण की भगवत्ता को भुला देती हैं, और कृष्ण भगवान है, यशोदा मैया भी ये भूल जाती हैं, तभी ये मधुर लीलाएं होती हैं। इसलिए मटके को फोड़ा और हाथ में डंडा लेकर मारूं, और कृष्ण उसके पीछे में भाग रहे हैं, मैया मुझे मत मार, रो रहे हैं, सचमुच रो रहे हैं। तो ये भक्ति कैसे हुई? कृष्ण को तो प्रसन्नता हुई नहीं, नहीं, कृष्ण के लिए ही है। क्यों? हमारा लड़का पीछे बिगड़ जाएगा, चोरी करेगा, लोगों से लड़ेगा, इसलिए बचपन में यदि नहीं सुधार दूं तो इसका जीवन चौपट हो जाएगा। उन्होंने उनको भगवान नहीं, अपना भोला भाला छोटा अबोध एक बच्चा समझ करके किया। यही ब्रजवासियों की मधुर सेवा है, इसलिए ये भक्ति के अनुकूल है। ये तो थोड़ी सी बात, कृष्ण कुछ गड़बड़ कर देते हैं, राधिका के पास ना आकर के चंद्रावली के पास में चले जाते हैं, गोपियां कहती हमारे कुंज से निकल जाओ, राधा जी कहती हैं हम लोग काला कुछ भी नहीं दर्शन करने चाहते, इसको निकालो। और कृष्ण राधा जी के पैया पड़ते हैं, ये भक्ति की चरम सीमा है। और इसीलिए कृष्ण कहते हैं मैं तुम्हारा ऋणी हूं जन्म जन्मांतर के लिए, ब्रह्मा की लंबी आयु पाकर के भी तुम्हारे ऋण से ऋण नहीं हो सकता। यह है ब्रज की भक्ति। ब्रज के सखा लोग कृष्ण को कभी दंडोत प्रणाम नहीं करते, अपने मुंह का जूठा निकाल कर, ये तो बहुत मीठा फल है, निकाल करके और कृष्ण के मुख में देते हैं। ये ब्रज की भक्ति है। श्रीदाम और सुबल कृष्ण से लड़ाई में कंस को मारा, चारुण मुष्टि को मार दिया, और सुबल सका से लड़ने में सुबल ने कृष्ण को पराजित कर दिया। ऐसी ब्रज की मधुर लीलाएं हैं। ये है भक्ति का उदाहरण दिया। पहले हम लोगों को एट फर्स्ट वी शुड डिफाइन स्वरूप सिद्धा भक्ति एंड देन अदर। यू विल सी इन विश्वनाथ चक्रवर्ती ठाकुर टी व्हाट इज स्वरूप सिद्धा भक्ति। अन्याभिलाषी अनुकूलन कृष्णानुशीलन, डिफाइन दिस एंड आफ्टर दैट यू शुड डिफाइन ओ तटस्थ लक्षण, देन इट विल बी ओके। ये तो बतलाया भक्ति का। अभी ठीक से और समझिए, एक उदाहरण दे करके मैं समझा रहा हूं। महाराज दशरथ कैकेयी के कहने से अपनी प्रतिज्ञा को रक्षा करने के लिए मन ही मन में कुछ संकल्प किया, रामचंद्र जी से जानकर तुरंत एकदम तैयार हो गए और भैया लक्ष्मण जी को और सीता जी को पहले बहुत समझाए जे मत हमारे साथ में आओ, वन जंगल में जाना बड़ा कठिन है, किंतु दोनों मानो नहीं। फिर कौशल्या सुमित्रा जी के आज्ञा से वो लोग भी इनके साथ में गए, वन में चले गए। वहां पर वो निषादों का राजा उससे मिल करके और फिर चित्रकूट में चले गए। उस समय में भरत जी ननिहाल में थे, वशिष्ठ जी की आज्ञा से कोई जा करके उनसे ले आया। जब आए तो अयोध्यापुरी में प्रवेश किया तो कहते मेरे स्वागत के लिए कोई आया नहीं, और यह नगरी तो विधवा जैसी लग रही है, न जाने क्यों सभी लोग मेरी उपेक्षा करके चले जा रहे हैं। को चिंता हुई, सोचा जे महाराज पिताजी कैकेयी के भवन में होंगे। कैकेयी के भवन में गए, देखा ये तो सफेद कपड़े पहन रखे हैं, सिर में सिंदूर नहीं है। भैया ये क्या बात है, पिताजी कहाँ हैं? तुम्हारे पिताजी का स्वर्गवास हो गया। भैया राम नहीं थे, लक्ष्मण नहीं था? तो नहीं, वो कहाँ हैं? वो वन जंगल में चले गए हैं। किस लिए? बेटा मैं तुम्हारे राजगद्दी के लिए मैंने ये सब किया, राजा से दो बार मांग लिया था रामचंद्र जी 14 वर्ष के लिए वन में जाएं और भरत उसके बदले में राजा हो। तेरे लिए क्या? ओ मेरे लिए तू डाइंड है, आज से तू हमारी माता नहीं हुई, मैं माता पिता, माता और पुत्र का संबंध आज त्याग कर दिया, और राम नहीं यदि हमारे ऊपर में प्रसन्न होते आज तुम्हें काट देता। और शत्रुघ्न जी जी कुबड़े को, कुबड़ी को पकड़ करके अपने लातों से मारा, भर जी ने मना। और इसके बाद में महा वशिष्ठ ऋषि को और वहाँ की सब प्रजाओं को, अपनी सेना को और कौशल्या मैया को, सुमित्रा को लेकर के चले, तो कैकई रोने लगी और उनसे कौशल्या से कहा, जी बहन हमको भी साथ में लो, हम राम से अपनी प्रतिज्ञा को उल्टा करके उनको लाने की चेष्टा करेंगे। उन्होंने उनको भी ले लिया, गए चित्रकूट में। चित्रकूट में पहुंचे जब, तो सबसे पहले कौशल्या मैया से उन्होंने कहा, मैया तू जो कहेगी राम को आदेश देगी, जरूर उनको पालन करना हो, जरूर पालन करेंगे। हाँ बेटा ये तो ठीक है, तो तुम राम से भैया से कहो जो अयोध्या लौट जाए, राज सिंहासन लेकर के वहां पर रहे। उन्होंने कौशल्या मैया ने कहा, जी मैं तो ऐसा नहीं कर सकती, क्यों, क्या मैं गलत हूं? नहीं गलत नहीं, तुम ठीक हो, किंतु राम भी तो गलत नहीं है, वो तो इतना धर्म में स्थिर है एक हिमालय पर्वत की भांति, वो टस से मस नहीं होगा, और उसकी बात ठीक है, पिताजी के आदेश को वो कैसे टाल सकता है, मैं नहीं कर सकती। फिर वशिष्ठ जी के यहां गए, गुरुदेव आप जो कह देंगे जरूर मानेगा, उसको आप आदेश दीजिए। उन्होंने कहा, जे बेटे मैं तो ये नहीं कर सकता, क्यों, क्या मैं गलत हूं? नहीं आप ठीक हैं, तुम ठीक हो, तू प्रेम की, प्रेम का तुम अथाह अनंत समुद्र हो, उसमें हिमालय जैसा पर्वत भी डूब जाएगा तो राम हिमालय के समान है, डूब तो जाएगा किंतु टस से मस इधर नहीं जाएगा, इसलिए मैं कैसे कहूं ये अपने पिता की आज्ञा छोड़ करके चली जाए। हुआ जैसे दूसरे दिन सभा बैठेगी और उसी समय में महाराज जनक वहां पर उपस्थित हुए। दूसरे दिन के लिए सभा हुई, विराट सभा में एक तरफ में वशिष्ठ जी, महाराज जनक और ऋषि महर्षि बैठे, एक तरफ में भरत, एक तरफ में श्री रामचंद्र, लक्ष्मण सीता बैठे और नगर के लोग सब बैठे। महाराज महर्षि वशिष्ठ जी ने कहा, आज अयोध्या की नाव समुद्र के बीच में डगमग डगमग कर रही है, कोई इसको खेने वाला नहीं है, किंतु ठीक समय पर महाराज जनक जी उपस्थित हुए हैं। ये भरत के भी जैसे पिता हैं और गुरु हैं, वैसे ही रामचंद्र जी के भी गुरु और उनके पिता के स्वरूप में हैं। मैं इनसे निवेदन करता हूं कि ये दोनों का क्या कर्तव्य है स्थिर करके बतलाएं और उसी के अनुसार में ये लोग करें। फिर उन्होंने जनक जी को कहा, जी महाराज आप जो कुछ स्थिर करेंगे ये दोनों भाई मानने के लिए बाध्य होंगे। महाराज जनक रामचंद्र जी की ओर में देखा, क्या हमारी बात मानोगे? तो आप हमारे गुरु और पिता है, जरूर मानूंगा। भरत की तरफ देखा, भरत जी कहना आपने जो निर्णय कर देंगे हम उसको सिर पर रख करके मानेंगे। उन्होंने ध्यान लगाया अपने गुरु को, शंकर जी उनके गुरु हैं, ठीक है ध्यान लगाया और बोले, भगवान शंकर जो हमसे कहेंगे वही हम कहेंगे। सोच करके थोड़ी देर रुका, भरत की जीत हुई, सब लोग बड़े आनंदित हुए, भरत भी आनंदित हुआ। भरत की जीत हुई माने क्या, अयोध्या में लौट करके सिंहासन ले लेंगे,
राम जी जाके लेना पड़ेगा।
फिर कहते हैं कि देखो भरत की जीत हुई बात तो ठीक है, किंतु प्रेम की भी एक मर्यादा होती है। भरत के प्रेम में राम डूब गए, अर्थात तो राम को भरत की बात माननी है, ठीक है, किंतु प्रेम की एक मर्यादा है। क्या है? हमारा इष्ट देव जो है, जो हमारा जिसको हम प्रेम करते हैं, वो किस में खुशी रहता है भरत को जानना चाहिए। अभी तक तो भरत तुम अपने लिए सोच रहे थे, रामचंद्र जी यदि वन चले जाएंगे तो हमें बड़ा कष्ट होगा, सबको बड़ा कष्ट होगा, राम को कष्ट होगा कि नहीं ये नहीं सोचते थे। तुम सोचो जो तुम्हारा इष्ट देव राम किस में सुखी है और उसकी बात मानो, तब तो तुम्हारा इष्ट देव के प्रति यथार्थ प्रेम है। सुनकर के भरत जी बोले, आज मेरी आंखें खुल गई, मैं स्वार्थी था, मैं स्वार्थ के लिए राम को लौटा लेना चाहता था, आप गुरु ने हमारी आंखें खोल दी। राम के पास गए और चरणों में बोल गिर करके बोले, भैया तुम क्या चाहते हो, तुम किस में सुखी रहोगे? उन्होंने कहा, जे तुम्हारी तो जीत हो गई है, मैं अयोध्या का राज्य हमने स्वीकार किया, किंतु एक बात है, तुम हमारा 14 वर्ष तक प्रतिनिधि रहकर और हमारे राज्य की रक्षा करो, और 14 वर्ष के बाद में बिना एक दिन देरी किए हुए मैं लौट आऊंगा, अपना सिंहासन ले लूंगा। बस भरत जी ने उनकी खड़ाऊं सिर पर रखी और रह करके राम की परिक्रमा की और लौट गए। इसके द्वारा ये समझिए, हम जो चाहते हैं वो भक्ति नहीं है। कृष्ण क्या चाहते हैं? डू व्हाट एवर यू डू, डू फॉर कृष्ण, टू प्रेज कृष्ण, कृष्ण को प्रसन्न करने के लिए करो। और जब तक राम की सेवा करने से मुझे बड़ा आनंद होगा, ये भक्ति, अपना आनंद भक्ति नहीं है। यशोदा जी ने कभी नहीं देखा अपना आनंद, नंद बाबा जी ने नहीं देखा, गोपियों ने अपना आनंद नहीं देखा। गोपियां श्रृंगार करती हैं कृष्ण को प्रसन्न करने के लिए, अन्यथा उनके शरीर पर, शरीर में तनिक भी कोई आसक्ति नहीं है। इसलिए भक्ति का यह तात्पर्य है, आप लोग भी समझ बुझ करके जो कुछ जीवन में करें भगवान को प्रसन्न करने के लिए। भगवान तो जरा दूर है ना, इसलिए गुरु को, और जो गुरु नहीं, सदगुरु नहीं किया है जो आपके तत्व ज्ञान को दे सके, संसार से विरक्त नहीं है और भगवान की अनुभूति नहीं है, फिर दूसरा गुरु करो और करके इन तत्वों को समझ करके और तब भगवान का भजन करो। गौर प्रेमानंदे, अच्छा ट्रांसलेशन,
So, we've heard, what is the definition of devotion? Actually, what we're performing now is not really devotion. Therefore, Gurudev says we can hear this definition of devotion and we can understand whether our practice is in line with this definition of pure bhakti. Therefore, that activities performed for the pleasure of Sri Krishna, performed by the body, mind, words, and emotions in a way that is favorable for Krishna, which is not covered by karma or jnana, and is performed uninterruptedly. This can be called pure devotion. Therefore, we heard, what does it mean for the happiness of Krishna? In the definition of devotion, we heard that the two wrestlers, Charan and Mustik, they had come to kill Krishna. As they were fighting Krishna, then Krishna was very happy. But we cannot call this devotion because their mood was not to give happiness to Krishna. Their mood was to kill Krishna. Therefore, their mood is pratikul or opposed to devotion. And on the other hand, Mother Yasoda, she was churning milk, churning yogurt to extract the butter for him. But Krishna broke that pot of yogurt and Mother Yasoda took a stick and chasing Krishna, she grabbed him. Oh, rascal boy, I will beat you. And seeing that stick in the hand of Mother Yasoda, Krishna began weeping. Who is Krishna? He is the Supreme Controller. Who is Krishna? He is endowed, he is possessed of unlimited power and potencies. Millions and millions of universes emanate from him, but today he is afraid of the stick in the hand of his mother. Question comes, is Krishna pretending to be afraid of the stick in the hand of his mother? No. Yogamaya, or Krishna's potency which arranges his activities, arranged that Krishna forgot I am the Supreme Lord, and Madhya Soda thinks Krishna is my son. Therefore, when she took the stick, I will beat you. Really, Krishna is not joking or pretending. He is weeping. Then someone may ask, is this devotion making Krishna cry? The answer is a resounding yes. Because Mother Yasoda is thinking, if I do not chastise my son and control him and teach him the path of good behavior, maybe after he'll become a criminal or a thief, his life will be disturbed. Therefore, his benefit, I am chastising and making him cry. Therefore, this is pure devotion. Therefore, she never thinks that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. She always thinks that Krishna is her son. Another example is when Sri Krishna leaves the association of Srimati Radhika and goes with other gopis like Chandavali. That time, Srimati Radhika is very angry with Krishna. She gives an order to her servants, don't let that black fellow in here. He is black inside and out. In fact, nothing black should come within my vision. And she gives many types of abuses to Krishna. And Gurudev says, is this bhakti? This is the topmost level of devotion. In fact, that type of devotion is so high that Krishna himself admits, na pariham the devijo samjujam. O gopis, I cannot repay your spotless service. I am indebted to you. Krishna said, even if I had a very, very long lifetime, I cannot repay my indebtedness to you. Therefore, this mood is called Braja Bhakti, or devotion in Vrindavan. The coward boys, they never give pranam to Krishna. If they're eating some good fruit, they give in the mouth of Krishna. Take this, it's very nice. Then someone may think, this is offense, but this is not offense. This is pure devotion, because they're doing only for Krishna's enjoyment. The friends like Sridhar and Subal, they wrestle with Krishna and defeat him by throwing him on the ground. But Krishna feels great happiness by this. Therefore, these are some examples of the sweet dealings in Vrindavan. Guru Maharaj said, here is a nice example so you can understand what is devotion actually. When Dasarath Maharaj had given two promises to his wife, Kaikeyi, therefore Kaikeyi demanded on the eve of Ram's coronation of king, give me these two promises. What do you want? I want that Ram will go to the forest for 14 years and I want my son Bharat will be king. Therefore, Dasarath Maharaj was forced to keep his words. Therefore, Ram was going to the forest alone, but Lakshman and Sita, they requested, we will go to the forest with you. Then Ramji tried in very various ways to make them understand forest life is very difficult. But finally, all went to the forest, all three. At that time, Ram went to, as he entered the forest, he met Guyaka, the king of the forest people. Then from there he went to Chitrakut. So meanwhile, Ram's brother, Bharat, he was not in Ayodhya when all this was going on. He was in another city, Nanital. Therefore, when Bharat, he came back to Ayodhya, the city of Ram, then he saw No one is welcoming me. No one is welcoming me. Everyone looks very much depressed. A yogi looks like a widow. In fact, people are neglecting me. What's happening? Therefore, he thought, I cannot see my father. Maybe my father is with my mother, Kaikeyi. Therefore, Bharatji went there to the palace of his mother. And he saw my mother is dressed in white cloth. In India, when the husband dies, then the lady puts on white cloth and does not put any decoration on herself. And he saw my mother has white cloth and no decorations, no ornaments. What happened? She said, oh, your father has achieved a higher destination. Means he's left this world. Then he said, I cannot see Ram or Sita. Oh yes, I have done this for you. I requested two benedictions from your father, that Ram will go to the forest and that you will be king. I have done all this for you. Then Bharat became very angry. I will never call you mother. I will call you Queen Kaikeyi, but I will never call you mother. Our relationship is finished because you have opposed and offended Ram. Therefore Bharatji, he took all the citizens and ministers to the forest to try to persuade Ram, you should come back to the Ayodhya and enjoy the happiness of being the king. Therefore, especially Bharat was very intelligent. He took three people with him because he knew that Ram always listens to the advice of three people. One was his mother, Kausalya. One was Vaishishta, Gurudev, and Janak Mata. Janak came after. Anyway, so they all went to the forest. Then Bharatji prayed to the mother of Ram. Oh, you please, if you request Ram to come to the forest, he will always obey your instructions. He must come back. Then Kausalya said, I cannot do that. And Bharat said, am I wrong in my thinking? She said, no, your thinking is perfectly correct. But how I can tell Ram to give up the order of his father? I cannot do that. So then Bharatji went to the Guru, Vasishta, and said the same thing. Oh Gurudev, if you order Ram to come back to Ayodhya, then he must follow your instruction. Then Guru said, I cannot do that. Then Bharatji said, am I wrong in my thinking? No, your thinking is perfect. Your prayer is like an ocean, and Ram's following of religious principles is like a Himalayan mountain. Himalaya never moves. It stays very strong. And sometimes even the ocean may cover a mountain, but the mountain remains fixed in his position. Therefore, I cannot order Ram to give up the order of his father. Then finally, Janak Maharaj came. Then Bharatji said, oh, Janak Maharaj, you are like the Guru. If you order Ram to return to the city, then he must return to the city and become king. Then Janak Maharaj said, I will give an answer tomorrow. Therefore, the next day in the forest, Janak Maharaj, Vasishtha Rishi and the other saints were on one side. In the middle was Ram, Lakshman and Sita. And on the other group was the various citizens watching. And Bharatji, he was also there. Therefore, Bharatji asked, Vasishtha Rishi said, now the boat of Ayodhya is rocking in the ocean, it's about to sink. But we have been saved by the presence of the great knowledgeable saint named Janak. Therefore, please give an answer to the question. Therefore, Janakji said, if I give an answer, everyone will accept. Then Bharatji said, yes, we will accept your order. And Ramji said, whatever you say, we will follow. So Janak Maharaj closed his eyes and he remembered his spiritual master, Lord Shiva, Shankar. And he said, whatever Shankar inspires in my heart, I will give that answer. Therefore, all agreed to accept the opinion of Janak Maharaj. So, Janak Maharaj said, Bharat has won. And everyone became ecstatic. Haribol. That means Bharat has won. That means Ram must come back to the kingdom. He will become king. Therefore, everyone was very, very happy. But then Janak Maharaj said, still, one thing you should answer. Oh, Bharat, can you tell me what is prema? What is pure love? And Bharat thought, he said, I cannot answer. Gurudev, you tell me, what is the definition? What is the meaning of prema, pure devotion? Then Janak Maharaj said, prema also has its own rule. It's marjada. What is that? In prema, one should only have one thinking. How I can please my Lord. How I can please my worshipful deity. Therefore, Bharat, you should think, what does Ram want? How can I make Ram happy? Then Bharat began weeping. Oh really, I never knew what was prem. Until today, my eyes were closed. But your answer has opened my eyes. Because I was only thinking of myself, Bharat said. Because I was thinking, if Ram comes back to the city of Ayodhya, I will be very happy. But I never asked Ram, what do you want? How I can please you? Therefore, weeping, he asked Ram, oh please Ram, you tell me your desire and I will follow your order, your instruction. I want to please you. Then Ram said, I want that I will go to the forest for 14 years. And I will take the kingdom and I will give it to you as my representative. Therefore, I will go to the forest and I want you to be king of Ayodhya as my representative. And after 14 years, I will return. I will not be one day late. Therefore, Bharat took the shoes of his brother Ram on his head and went back to Ayodhya as representative of the king. Therefore, Gurudev says, what is devotion? Devotion means everything I do is for Krishna's happiness, how I can please him. We should not think, oh, I am doing devotion, I am very happy, Haribol. This is not devotion. Devotion does not mean for your own enjoyment. Madhya Soda, Nanda Baba, the gopis never think, I will serve Krishna and I will be happy. Even the gopis have no attachment to their body. The only attachment they have to their body is so this body gives happiness to Krishna. Therefore, Gurudev says, the Supreme Lord Krishna, we have not seen him. He is very, very far. Therefore, first we should try to please the spiritual master who is the representative of Krishna. What he wants, we should fulfill his desire. Then Krishna would be pleased. And if we have no guru, or maybe we've chosen a guru who is not really a bona fide spiritual master, he is not expert in all spiritual conclusions, that we may have chosen a spiritual master who is not completely renounced, or we may have chosen someone who has not had complete realization of the Supreme Lord, what should we do? We should give up that false guru and accept the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master, then we can practice pure devotion.
Aaj Hari Katha ka यहीं पर विश्राम हो रहा है और कल इसके बाद में आरंभ होगी भागवत की कथा. आप लोग 6 बजे तक जरूर आ जाएंगे और संक्षेप में यहां का ड्रामा प्ले करेंगे जिससे कि हम लोगों को अधिक समय मिले जो हम लोग भागवत पर बोल सकें.
Jai Srila Gurudev Ki Jai. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jai Jai Shri Radhe.